From Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter 8, titled Questions by King Parikshit, text number 18. Nirunam sadharano dharma savisheshascha yadrishaha shreni nam rajarshi nam cha dharma krichreshu jivatam. Line by line. Nirunam sadharano dharma Savisheshascha yadrishaha Shreni nam rajarshi nam cha Dharma krichreshu jivatam Nirunam sadharano dharma Savisheshascha yadrishaha Shreni nam rajarshi nam cha Dharma krichreshu jivatam. Anybody would like to leave? Runam sadharano dharma Visheshascha yadrishaha Shreni nam rajarshi nam cha Dharma krichreshu jivatam. Anyone else? Nirunam sadharano dharma Savisheshascha yadrisha Shreni nam rajarshi nam cha Dharma krichreshu jivatam. Word to word translation. Nirunam, of human society. Sadharana, general. Dharmaha, religious affiliation. Savisheshaha, specific. Cha, also. Yadrishaha, as they are. Shreni nam, of the particular three classes. Rajarshi Nam, of the saintly royal order. Cha, also. Dharmaha, occupational duty. Krichreshu, in the matter of distressed conditions. Jivatam, of the living beings. Translation and purport by Stephen Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki. Please also explain what may generally be the common religious affiliations of human society, as well as their specific occupational duties in religion, the classification of the social orders, as well as the administrative royal orders, and the religious principles for one who may be in distress. Purport. The common religion of all classes of human beings, regardless of whosoever and whatsoever one may be, is devotional service. Even the animals may be included in devotional service to the Lord, and the best example is set by Sri Vajrangaji or Hanuman, the great devotee of Lord Sri Ram. As we have already discussed, even the aborigines and cannibals can also be engaged in the devotional service of the Lord, if they happen to be under the guidance of a genuine devotee of the Lord. In the Skanda Purana, there is a narration that a hunter in the jungle became the most enlightened devotee of the Lord by the guidance of Sri Narada Muni. Therefore, devotional service to the Lord can be equally shared by every living being. Religious affiliation in terms of different countries and cultural circumstances is obviously not the common religion of the human being. Rather, the basic principle is devotional service. Even if a particular type of religious principle does not recognize the supremacy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the followers still have to obey the disciplinary principles laid down by a particular leader. Such a leader of a religious sect is never the supreme leader, because such a circumstantial leader comes to the position of leadership after undergoing some penance. The Supreme Personality of Godhead does not, however, require to be under disciplinary action to become leader, as we see in the activities of Lord Krishna. The occupational duties of the castes and the orders of society, following the principles of livelihood, also depend on the principle of devotional service. In the Bhagavad Gita, it is stated that a person can achieve the highest perfection of life simply by awarding the results of his occupational duty unto the devotional service of the Lord. People following the principles of devotional service to the Lord can never be put into difficulty, and thus there cannot be any question of apad dharma or religion in distress. As will be explained in this book by the greatest authority, Srila Sukadeva Goswami, there is no religion save and except the devotional service of the Lord, though this may be presented in different forms. Om Tat Sat. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnana Jana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parjana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha. Hare Krishna Karuna Sindho Dhina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanasute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Ancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangu Langayate Girim Yatkrupatamaham Vande Shri Guru Dinataranam Paramananda Madhavam Shri Chaitanya Mishwaram. First of all, I would like to seek the blessings of all the assembled senior devotees so I may be able to speak something relevant here. We'll read the translation. Please also explain. King Parikshit is asking Sukadeva Goswami, please also explain what may generally be the common religious affiliations of human society as well as the specific occupational duties in religion, the classification of the social orders as well as the administrative royal orders, and the religious principles for one who may be in distress. We have this beautiful Srimad Bhagavatam primarily because of Parikshit Maharaj's inquisitiveness. He has a set of questions that he is placing before Srila Sukadeva Goswami, the answer to which forms this entire Mahapurana of Srimad Bhagavatam. Just as Srila Prabhupada explains in the Bhagavad Gita that Arjuna, being an intimate associate of the Supreme Lord, he can not be an illusion, but just for the sake of our understanding, he presents himself as somebody that is under illusion and asks questions and Lord Krishna is answering. Similarly, it looks like before making this statement as to what is the sadharana dharma, what is the vishesha dharma, and what is the apad dharma. If we see the shlokas before in this chapter and the previous chapter, Maharaj Parikshit presents a very high level of understanding of Krishna consciousness, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, because he was a Rajarshi. He hails from a family of pure devotees. So his questions are for us to understand the truth in proper perspective. In this shloka, even though Parikshit Maharaj is asking about dharma, three types of dharma, and subsequent shlokas also is repeating, repeatedly requesting Shukadeva Goswami to explain about what is dharma. Here we see there is sadharana dharma, vishesha dharma, and apad dharma. Three types of dharma are explained. As we know, dharma, the term dharma in Vedic tradition is very heavily loaded. It forms the bedrock of a lot of our understanding in Vedic culture. And in due course of time, many people have given various connotations to the term dharma. You know, in this verse, there are three types of dharma, but this is not an exhaustive list of the types of dharma. Sadharan dharma, general dharma, and apad dharma. What other dharmas are there? How many other dharmas we have heard of? Varnashram dharma, Grihastha dharma, Sannyas dharma, Brahmachari dharma, Vanaprastha dharma, Stri dharma, Purusha dharma, Raj dharma, Kula dharma, Jati dharma. So many, it just goes on and on and on and on. And Swayambhu Manu gives a lot of details about all these various types of dharma. For example, all these things, according to this shloka, according to what Srila Prabhupada is explaining in the purport, come under general dharma or vishesha dharma or apad dharma. Vishesha dharma, special category. Vishesha dharma is dharma specific to the living entity situation. For example, Raj dharma. Only somebody who's a king is supposed to or is expected to follow that. So it is specific to a situation. So Raj dharma deals with how a king should serve his subjects. And then we have Pati dharma, how a husband should serve the wife, and vice versa. No, Patni dharma is there. Then we have Putra dharma, how children should serve the parents, and then we have also vice versa. All these different types of dharma are explained in the scriptures. Generally, Vishesha dharma deals with, or it describes how human beings should deal with each other. So Vishesha dharma's boundaries are limited to only human beings, or maybe their dependents like animals, household animals and stuff. But here, even though Parikshit Maharaj is asking a question, Srila Prabhupada is directly giving the answer. And not just directly giving the answer, very forcefully giving the answer. See the first line. The common religion of all classes of human beings is devotional service. This is directly giving answer. You know how he makes it forceful? Regardless of whosoever and whatsoever one may be. We have in this world many books of who's who. The country's who's who, the city's who's who, the world's who's who. I am such and such. You know, I am. If we don't have external titles, we have internally assumed titles. You know, I'm a very respected gentleman. You know, so why? Because I expect a lot of respect. Not that I have received respect so much yet, but it's coming soon. So Now I'm a respected gentleman. So Prabhupada is saying that the common religion is devotional service irrespective of whatever background is, irrespective of whatever present situation is. Now, we have heard that devotional service is the most important thing. In fact, Srila Prabhupada's teachings take us from Sadharana Dharma to Parodharma. Right? We'll discuss about Parodharma in a little bit. Who likes to be in the general category and who likes to be in the special category among us? Everybody wants to be in general category or anybody likes to be in special category? Means you go to Tirupati, general category is very long line, right? One full day waiting or something. Then you always look for opportunities to go in special category, right? And recently we went to, many devotees went to Kanchipuram to take darshan of Lord Attivaratar. And luckily I went early in the season before the crowd picked up. So in the general line we waited for about 5 hours. And then my parents were elderly, were there. They went in senior citizen queue and they took about 1.5 hours, 2 hours. But then as we were getting close, we saw some families being accompanied by police constables going in the VIP line, because the police constables are posted there for duty. So there are different levels of specialty, you know. And those who are standing in the general line were looking at the senior citizen, and I wish I was a senior citizen, you know. And once you get closer, you see the VIP line, everybody is thinking, I wish I was a VIP or at least some VIP contact I had. So the desire for specialty is very, very intrinsic. In fact, that is the reason why we are here in the material world in the first place, because we wanted to be special. The spiritual world, there is only one person who is special. He gives specialty to others, but we should not expect. Anyway, so we like to be treated very special. But according to this particular purport, more special than being special is being ordinary. Right? Srila Prabhupada says, devotional service is the common dharma. And that is something that has to be followed irrespective of what special status you have, special category you have or we have. So more special than being special is being ordinary, the general category. So our aspiration should be in the general category. How does it apply to us? In our day-to-day interactions with people in general, particularly with other devotees, if we have any inclination, if we have any desire to be given any special attention, to be given any special treatment, that is the tendency is there, but we should always strive to assume a place in the general category. What happens by doing that? We become dear to Krishna. Anyway, that is a sideline thing. It's not that special category is something that we should give up, we should, you know, we should make faces at or anything. Special category is like an anchor, you know. A boat or a ship has an anchor. An anchor is a good thing or a bad thing for a boat? Good? Anchor is good? Okay. Yeah, depending on where it is, right? You know, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur told us the story of the marriage party. You know, they got on this boat and the knight told the boatman that they have to cross the river for the marriage. You know, so the boatman agreed to row the boat all night long. The next day, the morning, everybody woke up and they were still in the same place because the boatman was rowing, he was sweating, panting, but then he forgot to take the anchor up. No? So anchor is neither good nor bad. Vishesha Dharma, for example, if I am a king, I'm not a king, luckily, if I am whatever, okay, we have certain dharmas. All these dharmas are like anchors. If a boat has to stay in one place, anchor has to be lowered. But if the boat has to move forward, the anchor has to be pulled. So when we have a certain responsibility to execute based on our situation, then we lower the anchor of our Vishesha Dharma. Yes, I am a father, I have a certain responsibility. You lower the anchor and do that responsibility. And once the responsibility is finished, certain rewards are going to come. If not rewards, something opposite also. So, in that situation, we have to take the anchor up and let the boat move forward towards general category, right? So we have to be willing. It is a dilemma between responsibility and reward. When we have to execute responsibility, it is very important for us to stick to our dharma, Vishesha Dharma, as long as it is not going against our Sadharana Dharma. But when rewards come, we may accept some reward for the sake of social etiquette. Just at a point when we are about to get too attached to those rewards, we should shift gears and move towards Sadharana Dharma. Now, in the scripture, we have so many examples of how Sadharana Dharma, Vishesha Dharma is applied. For example, Grihastha Dharma, if we see, in the Chaitanya Lila, we have the example of Srivas Thakur, and then we have the example of Shivananda Sen. Shivananda Sen was a wealthy businessman, landlord. He was serving devotees in varieties of ways by sponsoring their livelihood, by sponsoring their trips to meet Lord Chaitanya in Jagannath Puri. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very, very happy and pleased with Shivananda Sen. But when Srivas Thakur had one time shifted out of Mayapur, I forgot the name of that place where he shifted out after Mahaprabhu left Mayapur. Anyway, when Mahaprabhu went there to meet him, he asked Srivas Thakur, "Srivas, you know, all your occupation was there in Navadvip, but you have come here. How are you maintaining your family?" Srivas Thakur did. Mahaprabhu asked, "I am asking you a question, you are just clapping. What does it mean?" And Srivas Thakur replied to Mahaprabhu, "You know, Krishna is the provider. When I need something, I will clap my hands 3 times. If Krishna provides, I will take. Why he will not provide? He must provide." Mahaprabhu was in tears to see the surrender of Srivas Thakur. Now, both are Grihastha Dharma, both are Grihasthas, right? Shivananda Sen also had a large family, Srivas Thakur also had a large family, you know. And both were pleasing Mahaprabhu in their different ways of executing Grihastha Dharma, Vishesha Grihastha Dharma. And then if we see Raj Dharma, in the same Mahaprabhu's pastimes, we have the example of Pratapudra Maharaj and also Ramananda Rai. Ramananda Rai, when Mahaprabhu met Ramananda Rai for the first time, he was not sitting in his bhajan kutir chanting japa or anything. He was being carried on a palanquin by servants. You know, so many brahmanas chanting mantras in front of the palanquin and so many musicians beating drums and singing songs. It was a very, very opulent procession. And Mahaprabhu did not even hesitate a moment. As soon as he got an opportunity to meet him privately, he went and tightly embraced him. On the other side, Pratapudra Maharaj, he was begging and crying his heart out to get a moment of audience with Mahaprabhu. Mahaprabhu would not even hear his name. When devotees would tell Pratapudra's name, Mahaprabhu would say that, "You are spoiling my life here. If you say, if you bring his name to me one more time, I will leave Jagannath Puri and leave, go away." And both were performing their Rajadharma, you know, at different levels. And Mahaprabhu were were dealing with the two in a completely different way. And then we have the example of Raghunath Das Goswami and Raghunath Bhatt Goswami. You know, and Raghunath Das Goswami, Mahaprabhu told him, "You know, your parents are like worm in the stool. And it's not that they were like properly pakka karmis or anything, Raghunath Das Goswami's parents. They were sponsoring so many devotees. In fact, they would regularly organize Harikatha, Harikirtan. Haridas Thakur went there to do a katha in their residence. That's where Raghunath Das Goswami, you know, got connected to Krishna consciousness, if you can say so. But Raghunath Bhat Goswami wanted to leave and travel with Mahaprabhu. Mahaprabhu told him, no, you go and take care of your parents and you can join me later. Raghunath Das Goswami, you should leave at once. What are you doing there? Now, both are Vishesh Dharma, like Putra Dharma here, Putra Dharma there. You know? But Mahaprabhu gave two different instructions. So, Vishesh Dharma gives us some idea about our responsibilities, but we cannot take Vishesh Dharma as shelter. Because when we are seeking shelter, it is always good to take some stable shelter. Prabhuji was giving us a little tour of the construction site today, and most of the floor is very stable. In some places where there is some little kind of coverings, and I happened to keep my foot on some covering, it was very unstable. I immediately jumped out and stood on the concrete. So shelter means we always want stable shelter, not shaky shelter. So we should earnestly try to execute our Vishesha Dharma, but we should never take shelter of Vishesha Dharma. And before going little more deeply into Sadharan Dharma, we will also discuss briefly about Apat Dharma, which means what to do in emergency situations and what are the exceptions in such emergency situations. Now, Sanatana Goswami, he was imprisoned by the king. He was peacefully executing his devotional service. But then suddenly this Apat situation came. And in Apat situation, many exceptions are given, right? Apat situation, it's okay. In emergency situation, you can bend the rules a little bit. But Sanatana Goswami did not make any compromises. He could have easily said, when he received that message from his brother Rupa Goswami, he could have replied, anyway, it's an emergency situation, why take risk? Let me stay here, let me go back and, you know, help the king. At least, no, one of you, one person in our family is doing the seva, let the other person take care of the family. No, you know. So he took the risk of escaping from the prison, doing so much drama. And then another beautiful example is of Srila Prabhupada. You know, when he was 70 years of when he was 70 years old, he took on this cargo ship and traveled to the west. In the middle of the ocean, he got multiple heart attacks. That was an apat situation. For somebody of that age, he could have easily decided, I, Krishna, you know, I tried to do your work, I tried to serve you, but you are giving me heart attack, so I'm going back to Vrindavan. No. He persevered. He did not take the leverage, he did not take the exception of the apat situation. And Haridas Thakur also, when he was very, very old, Mahaprabhu came and asked him, you know, how he was doing. And Haridas Thakur, with tears in his hand, in his eyes, he was telling Mahaprabhu that he is the most fallen of all the fallen because he's not able to chant his rounds. And Mahaprabhu told him, you have chanted so many rounds, you know, and now you are so old, you can reduce the number of your rounds. And Haridas Thakur would not agree. That situation of invalidity is an apat situation. But Haridas Thakur would not accept that apat situation. And King Priyavrat in the Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, he left his Vishesha Dharma of being the prince or being the king, and he went to perform devotional service. It took so much effort for Lord Brahma to beg and plead and bring him back to take the responsibility of Vishesha Dharma. So, and also Bali Maharaj, you know, he made a promise, but then is, you know, we were discussing a couple of days ago that his Guru Shukracharya said, no, you can tell a lie, you can break a promise. These are certain situations where you don't have to follow your promise. And Shukracharya listed those promises, but Bali Maharaj, he did not take that exception of apat situation. No. I made a promise, I will stick to it. So when we are dealing with apat situation, there are two things. Oh, this is an emergency situation, I don't have to do. I'm in an emergency situation, I don't have to chant my rounds, or at least I don't have to chant my rounds attentively, you know. And I don't have to do this seva because I have an emergency situation. It's okay. Practically, we have to consider practical implications also. But then, it will be very pleasing for Guru and Krishna if we resist the temptation to take the exceptions of the apat situation and try to persevere. So, and on the other side, regarding apat dharma, what Krishna felt about apat dharma. It's very interesting in the Mahabharata how somebody was not sensitive to apat dharma. We have the case of Bhishma Pitamaha. He had his own putra dharma beliefs. He had made a promise to his father, so he was very, very stubbornly sticking to it. So much so that when there was a severe apat situation where Draupadi was about to be disrobed, he was almost, externally at least, insensitive, non-reactive to the apat situation. And that is okay, but then what did Krishna do at the end of it? Krishna still went back and gave an opportunity to him. He asked Bhishma if he can abandon the camp of Duryodhana. Why? Because Bhishma had favorable disposition towards the Pandavas. And Krishna did that with Karna also. At least Bhishma Dev did not act when Draupadi was being humiliated. But in Karna's case, Karna was the one who gave that suggestion of humiliating Draupadi. It was an extreme of adharma. But Krishna went and asked Karna, telling him that you are Kunti's son, you should leave Duryodhana and join Yudhishthira. Why? Because he was Kunti's son. Krishna is very, very favorably disposed to his devotees. No matter what we do, we should always be close to some devotees. Even if we do a lot of mistakes, even if we do big, big blunders, if some devotee thinks we are close to them, here Krishna knows that Karna is Kunti's son. Kunti has not told him. Krishna knows everything. And here Krishna is telling Karna that, Kunti is your mother. Karna says, yeah, I know. I got a sense earlier on. But still, because of that, because of his connection to Kunti, Krishna went and gave him an opportunity. Krishna keeps giving opportunities like that. So, that is, of course, in Karna also, in that situation when Krishna explained it was an apat situation, Karna should have left and followed his general dharma of devotional service. We'll discuss what is that. Here Prabhupada explains. The occupational duties of the castes and the orders of society, following the principles of livelihood, also depend on the principle of devotional service, which is sadharana dharma. The occupational duties of castes and orders of society is for what? For the principle of livelihood. But that also should depend on devotional service. Bhagavad Gita and Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, yat karoshi yadashnashi yat juhoshi dadashi yat whatever you do according to your occupational situation, your caste and your social situation, we should do it as an offering to Lord Krishna. If we do that, when we follow our Vishesha Dharma, following in the principle of devotional service, of offering all the results to Lord Krishna, what happens to our Vishesha Dharma? It becomes Parodharma. Savai Pumsam Parodharmo Yato Bhaktir Adokshaje. Ahaituki apratihata yayatma suprasidati. Why we should please Krishna? Yato bhaktir adokshaje. The ultimate substance, the essence of all religion, savai pumsam paro dharmo, is yato bhaktir adokshaje, to please the Supreme Lord adokshaja. And that devotional service should be uninterrupted and unmotivated. If it was like that, then yayatma suprasidati. It is completely satisfying. It is not just giving us happiness, it is completely satisfying. Nitya Siddha Krishna Prema Sadhya Kabunai Shravanadi Shuddha Chitte Karaya Udai. That eternal complete satisfaction is inside all of us. And devotional service to the Supreme Lord is the way of regaining that eternal satisfaction. Now, there are three types of devotees, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu explains: Kanishta Adhikari, Madhyama Adhikari, and Uttama Adhikari. Most of us are Kanishta Bhaktas. In Kanishta stage of devotional service, bhakti is interrupted. Bhakti should be ahaituki, it is said. Ahaituki bhakti will give us suprasidati. But as long as our bhakti is not ahaituki, it's interrupted, then it is very difficult to achieve suprasidati. We keep getting glimpses of some happiness, some satisfaction, but eternal, everlasting satisfaction we don't get. Devotional service in sadhana stage is very challenging. That's why we don't feel that satisfaction all the time. Anya bilashita shunyam jnana karma dhyana vritam anukulyena krishnanu shilanam bhaktiruttamam. Anya bilashita shunyam. There should not be any ulterior motives. And because we have ulterior motives in our devotional service, we don't feel that satisfaction. Highest level of devotional service is pure devotional service. In devotional service, it's very, very easy to get started. The Prabhupada explains that it is, even the animals may be included in devotional service to the Lord. If we happen to throw some prasad, extra prasad that we could not finish or we don't like or it's spoiled somewhere on the roadside, and if a dog comes and eats it, the dog's devotional service has started. There was no intention of pleasing Krishna at all, but still the devotional service has begun. So beginning of devotional service has been made so extremely easy. And staying in devotional service is moderately difficult. And advancing in devotional service is a little bit more difficult. It's not very, very extremely difficult or anything. We will see that. But this anya bilashita, we have to be very meticulously working on that, to analyze, to introspect and understand the ulterior motives we have in devotional service. We have to eliminate that. Just like we pull weeds in the garden, if weeds grow very heavily, it will reduce the nutrition for the plant. So this weed of anarthas, they will choke the bhakti lata. So we have to be very meticulously removing the weeds. How do we do that? Tadviddhi pranipadena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshantite jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinah. If we do pariprashnena, then the process, then the activity of removing the weeds in our heart will begin. We should humbly take shelter of the spiritual master or a senior devotee and inquire submissively as to what we should work on in our quest for devotional service. Sevaya, service and service mood are very important. When we ask the spiritual master or the senior devotees for seva, a particular seva is given, and many times we have lots of constraints. I remember one story. One time when Srila Prabhupada was on a train traveling from some place to some place, when some of his devotees were there with him, and the train stopped in Delhi for some time, and suddenly, out of nowhere, Srila Prabhupada told Gurudas Prabhu, Yamuna Mataji and Banu Maharaj, at that time a brahmachari, that this is Delhi, I want you to go here and start a temple. And train was about to leave. You know, there was not much time to take guidance, take some credit cards or debit cards or some checks or something, nothing. Prabhupada said, go. And they got down. And they went and they started a temple. You know? Nobody is asking us to do that now. You know? Nobody is asking us to start a temple. Maybe sometimes devotees will ask us to distribute one Bhagavad Gita. Right? How difficult is it to start a temple? How difficult is it to distribute a book? There's a lot of difference. So we can do some small service, something that is given to us. So that is the seva mood. Yeah. There, Yamuna Mataji, Gurudas, their seva was to serve Prabhupada in the train. They didn't say, Prabhupada, yesterday you told us that we should come with you to Jaipur or wherever, now today you are changing. No question. Service means it can be changed anytime. So we should try to be attached to being a servant and not so much to the service. So the master might tell us one thing today, a different thing tomorrow. But Kali Yuga is different. Servants also demand a lot of rights in the outside world. So, those of us who have experience dealing with some servants, you say something, you change the time, you make a little more expectation, I'm not coming. In a small level to big dharnas and everything, all the shows and everything. So a lot of things happen. But then in devotional service, the service mood is very important because the rewards are immense. It's not a meager material reward for which we are doing devotional service. What is that immense reward? Suprasidati, eternal complete satisfaction. And another time when Srila Prabhupada's pastimes, when there was some disagreement between the leaders within the Radha Damodar Sankirtan party, Tamal Krishna Maharaj, he had certain proposals, but then the other leaders did not agree. The issue went to Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada basically took most of the responsibilities from Tamal Krishna Maharaj and gave it to other devotees, and Tamal Krishna Maharaj was not happy. And he said, I might as well go to China. It is an expression in America saying that, basically I have nothing left because China is nothing, kind of thing, at that time. I might as well go to China. And Prabhupada said, yes, I want you to go to China. So Maharaj went to China. And because of that, we have so many devotees. Now if Prabhupada or some of our leaders say, I want you to go to China, we'll be very excited. China jane mil rahe. We'll go and see China. Now we have that mood of, because we know there are some devotees and we know arrangements. At that time there was nothing, So Tamal Krishna Maharaj, all alone, he went there risking his life, He established Krishna consciousness there. So our specific vishesha dharma or our vishesha situation need not hold us down. When we are trying to perfect our individual dharmas, whatever it may be, and we don't need to really get stuck there. Our goal should always be to execute our sadharana dharma, general dharma, devotional service. Sadharana dharma should go on under the guidance of a guru or a senior devotee, an acharya. Srila Prabhupada's books are there for our guidance. They are the purest knowledge. They are the highest shelter. And ISKCON is a practical manifestation of that highest and purest shelter. ISKCON is a practical manifestation of Srila Prabhupada's books. ISKCON is pure like Ganga. Sometimes we see Ganga, there are so many impurities floating. Dirt, sometimes stool and some dead carbs may be floating. But still, we take a bath and become purified in Ganga. So when we are in this society, there will be a lot of impurities. But ISKCON is pure, the impurities are us, me. I am the primary, that's how we should think when we are faced with certain challenging situations. And if we take shelter of Prabhupada's books, his teachings and the processes of devotional service of chanting Harinam, worshipping the deities, regularly hearing Bhagavatam in the association of devotees, then we will keep getting purified. If we plug in to this compassion of Srila Prabhupada and remain plugged in this compassion, which is ISKCON, then we can easily achieve eternal complete satisfaction. This eternal satisfaction is timelessness. Sometimes we eat some nice rasgulla or something, or nice ice cream. How much we hanker that experience of eating that ice cream lasts for longer, but ice cream quickly melts and disappears, right? So, but we wish we could eat more, but then it becomes too much, our body cannot take it. But that complete satisfaction is eternal. How do we understand that? How do we understand the timelessness? And I remember reading in one BTG article by Ravindra Swarup Prabhu that eternality is a state where there is no influence of time. We have that experience, you know, some of us who have taken international flight, sometimes you start from one place on Tuesday, but then you reach the destination on Monday. Means you can reach on Wednesday, right? But then you save time. Time goes in reverse direction. You know, so they call it jet lag or whatever, time difference, time zone difference. But then we have the experience of time acting in the opposite side. But spiritual world is a place where time is still. And Ravindra Swarup Prabhu explained in that article that when we cross the Viraja River and enter the spiritual world, it would be as if we never left. You know, everything would continue as if there, as if it was just there the moment before. And all this experience of being in the material world is just like a moment forgetfulness of Krishna, a momentary forgetfulness of Krishna. It's very inconceivable. How can one moment we forget Krishna, but then we have many, many, millions of years, millions of lifetimes of material experience, you know? And Prabhuji explains that it is like a dream state. You know? Sometimes when we are if we take a nap for like say 1 hour or 2 hours, we have sometimes a dream where we are from our childhood, we go to our adulthood and we see so many things, right? We complete an entire lifespan of achieving a lot of things within 1 hour of nap. You know? So, if we can have that kind of compression in our small material experience, you know, Krishna can, you know, empower Maya Devi to give this 84 lakh species of life experience in one moment of forgetfulness. You know? In our dream state, we do a lot of things. You have seen, many of you might have seen children doing a lot of things in dreams. You know, talking, sometimes giggling, sometimes smiling, sometimes kicking. You know, all these things happen in dream. What do we do? If it is little children, we enjoy and we leave. But if it is an adult, if you're in ashram and you know you're trying to catch some sleep, get up early for Mangala Arati, and the other devotee next to you is trying to give Bhagavatam class in his dream. What do? We try to bring him to reality. Prabhuji, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, another 6 hours for Bhagavatam class, you please hold. You know? So, when we see somebody is not only having a bad experience, and we do that with children. When children, sometimes when they are sick, they go through a lot of terrible experiences in dream. Then we try to bring them out of that dream state. Shake them awake and say, no, you're okay. You know, you're fine, take it easy and, you know, and put them to comfort. So, when in all these experiences that we have, with the all compressed in one moment, is all achievements and our aspirations and everything in that dream state. So, it's one moment of dreaming, dream state, you know, which has so many days. How much value we should give to our achievements in our dream? How many of us remember being a king in the dream? In our, not so much now, in childhood. Yes. How many of us remember flying with wings or without wings in dream? Right? And how much importance have we given? The next day morning, get up, go on the terrace and jump and see if it works? No, we don't give importance. We just stay, right? We just give it, we just leave it. So, all these things, we're becoming a fish. When we are dreaming that we are fish, we try to become a big fish, like a shark or a whale. And when we are dreaming that we are an animal, we want to be the lion or tiger or something. And when we want to, when we are dreaming as if we are a human being, which now, and what are our aspirations? Now that we are in that particular section of our dream of being human beings, what are our aspirations? Very powerful, very influential, very wealthy, very respected human being, you know. And very soon this part of the dream will finish and we might go on to the section of being a demigod, right? So don't worry, even if we don't get what we want in this section of the dream, in the demigod section, it will be slightly better. In that section, we'll be aspiring, you know, this and that and this and that. So we know how Lord Indra was lovingly chastised by Lord Krishna many times for dreaming more than what he was dreaming. You know? So all these are dream state, you know, achievements in the dream. But our natural state is devotional service. If devotional service is so natural, why we have to struggle so much in devotional service? Particularly when devotional service requires us to control our senses. A natural state is very easy flowing, right? But why there is struggle? Because devotional service has various stages. Sadhana stage is there, which is a lot of struggle. Because we have not spent any energy in controlling our senses. You know? So we have to really struggle to control our senses. Sadhana bhakti is like swimming upstream. Sometimes when you try to cross a river or something, you should have to swim upstream, and then after a particular point, you can take advantage of the downstream. And the downstream is the Raghavanuga bhakti. For a few years, maybe for a few lifetimes if necessary, if we sincerely strive to control our senses, regulate our senses in sadhana bhakti, and by the mercy of the Lord, mercy of the spiritual master and the fellow devotees, if we develop some taste for chanting, develop some taste for hearing Krishna Katha, develop some taste for book distribution, doing some seva, then it is not so much struggle. Then things will flow, our seva will flow very easily. But until a time when we really love our service, we should do what is being asked of us. And that is the sadhana bhakti. So, in this particular shloka, as Prabhupada explains, that Vishesha Dharma should always follow Sadharana Dharma. Our occupational duties in specific situations should be seen as anchors. You know, use it when a particular responsibility has to be executed. Otherwise, lift up that anchor and move the boat towards pure devotional service. And the same thing will be explained later on by Srila Prabhupada in his purports when Sukadeva Goswami answers Parikshit Maharaja's questions in this section. Thank you very much. We'll stop here. If there are any discussion points, we'll take now anything. Prabhuji is asking to say a few more things about controlling the senses, because it is a big struggle. Trying to control senses in devotional service is like a battle. And battles need strategies. And battles need phalanxes of armies. So when it comes to controlling senses, the risk is very high if we try to fight the battle all alone. Association of devotees is very, very important. Strategy is very clearly laid out by Srila Prabhupada in his books. You know, the battle strategy is there. But we have to do it in the association of devotees. You know, they very rarely send a single soldier into any particular part of the mission. There are always buddies. They send at least two people, if not more. So in our devotional service means association of devotees. At least devotee, if not devotees, at least. You know. So if we try to do anything without the association of devotees, the struggle will continue. By Krishna's mercy, we will not be thrown out of the battle. We'll keep fighting, you know, unless we seriously offended some devotee. You know, otherwise, we'll keep struggling. So when it is difficult for us, when we are having difficulty controlling our senses, the first thing, take shelter of the association of devotees. You know. And if when in the association of devotees, together when we are trying to repose our senses in the higher tastes of Krishna, then we will see that things moving more naturally. You know? So only very, very exalted acharyas like Srila Prabhupada himself can execute devotional service all alone on the Jaladuta, in the New York City, before that in Butler. You know? And so for ordinary devotees, we need association. Whenever Krishna consciousness meter is going down, we have to check the association ledger. All the entries are complete or no. If some entries are missing, naturally the meter will go down. You know, so we have to go and fill the ledger association. If it is not practical to take personal association, we can take Srila Prabhupada's association by reading his books, put on the headphones and hear Prabhupada's lecture. The lectures of our spiritual masters, you know? So then it becomes easy for us to control our senses. Krishna consciousness is it's not just a mechanical process. Mechanical process means you turn the switch on, the machine runs according to design without direct awareness or direct influence of the engineer or the mechanic. Krishna consciousness is not a mechanical process. The designer is very, very personally involved in each and every small part of the machine, including the smallest screw and the washer. We may be very, very small, but Krishna is personally involved. You know, only Krishna can do it. Nobody can do it. So once, as Paramatma, when he sees our sincere desire to overcome a particular sensory urge, he is there, you know, rolling up his sleeves to help us, you know. But then we have to make some movement. We have to move. We have to take the first step. Now, if we don't, when somebody is throwing the rope, we should at least hold the rope, right? So, is it okay? Thank you, brother. Anything else? Yes. Yes. And the purport Prabhupada explains that the common religion for all classes of human beings, regardless of whosoever and whatsoever one may be, is devotional service. All of us have our vishesh dharma in various situations. But my understanding, the point that I heard I was trying to share was that this vishesh dharma should be seen as a matter of responsibility, not as a place of shelter. The shelter should be in sadharan dharma, devotional service. You know? And apadharma is something that we have to see. Apadharma gives us provisions and flexibility where we don't have to follow our vishesha dharma, sometimes even devotional service, sadharan dharma. But a sincere devotee should always strive to not take advantage of those exceptions and continue to strive. You know? So there are a lot of organizations and efforts put in discussing in detail about the Vishesh Dharma and establishing Vishesh Dharma and following Vishesh Dharma. You know, scriptures say, you know, Satyam Vada Dharmam Chara, but which Dharma to follow? Because our roles keep changing. And dharma is a very, very complex matter. If dharma was not so complex, we don't even have Mahabharata. Right? Such great personalities had such serious difficulties in understanding dharma. That's why, see, when you want to take shelter, you know, you want to be sure. If you're doing a favor to dharma, okay, instead of helping you, I will help here. But shelter is something, it's very, very critical. We should know for sure that the shelter is very stable. None of our Vishesha Dharma can give us shelter. Because that is all situational. Our situations will change and what kind of shelter it is. Right? So, and scriptures are full with so many stories of personalities taking shelter of their Vishesha Dharma, later on getting frustrated, eventually ending up, you know, forced to take shelter of devotional service only. You know? So, because we are all, of course, it's not that because most of us are grihasthas, even sannyasis have their dharma, you know, and grihasthas, we have our dharma, and when we try to follow our dharma, it should not hold us from performing our devotional service. It should enable, not disable. That's the point. That's the relationship between these dharmas.
So, just an extension.
Very good question. The answer is so... Prabhuji said that most of the times we spend our time in following Vishesha Dharma. Right? Specific to our body, we have to eat and we have to take care of the family and everything. So, how do we make sure we follow devotional service, which is Sadharan Dharma? I was just saying that the answer to this question is so extremely simple that we won't even notice it. You know, sometimes things are so simple that we don't notice it. Right? By Prabhupada's mercy, we have to cook to eat, that is our Vishesh Dharma. You offer to Krishna, it becomes Sadharan Dharma. 10 minutes in the middle. Right? So that is one example. That's, we discussed that shloka, Yat Karoshi, Yat Ashnoshi. Now, whatever we do, if we do it as an offering to Krishna, then our Vishesha Dharma becomes Sadharan Dharma. And apadharma also will become Sadharan Dharma if it is connected to Krishna. Dharma is very complex. One last question. Prabhuji asked that some of the Vishesha Dharmas are very easy to connect to Krishna consciousness, but some of the Vishesha Dharmas are not so direct and easy. For example, he said some devotees may be feeling inclined to appreciate and feel nice about being an Indian, being a Bharatvasi or Bharatiyata. But how is that connected to Krishna consciousness? How to connect it to Krishna consciousness? And because there is limited time, limited resources, and how can we spend time on justifiably on Krishna consciousness, at the same time also enriching that national identity? If we want to be proud of being an Indian, we should be proud of being the best Indian, which is Srila Prabhupada. If anybody has done good for India, the most is Srila Prabhupada. No? He was all alone. The government of India, none of the organizations of the India provide any support in the beginning days and years of Srila Prabhupada. We can see it as, oh, he didn't go for India, he went for Krishna, we can say. But when Srila Prabhupada, being the transcendental ambassador of Lord Krishna, who's from here, of course, from our country, even though he doesn't belong to any country, he boldly made that statement in London to the reporters that you are ruling us. Prabhupada didn't say he didn't say you are ruling them. He identified with India. Prabhupada said, I am one Indian. If I can do so much, you can do so much. All of us can do so much more. He identified with India. He did not shun away. Oh, no, I am transcendental. I don't belong to any country. I came from there. No. You know, he identified with India. Very strongly he identified with himself with India, with Bharat. But what did he do? He told the reporter, you took so much from us, but you forgot one thing, which is the most important. I have come to give it. What kind of a national pride is that for us when we hear that? When our cricket match, our cricket team wins a match, it's okay, it's good, we feel nice about it. Where is that pride when compared to we can go to a country who ruled us for 300 years and tell them that I have come something, you know, that you did not take, I want to give. I mean, just imagine somebody is coming and plundering everything from our home, you know, and we go the next day to the thief's house and, you know, I forgot, kitna pride, how much pride, take this, that is national pride, this bhakti tradition, this Krishna consciousness, that is the best cream, topmost layer, the plum of what India can have and give. And Prabhupada started this mission to give that to everybody. That is giving the top. If sometimes some foundation pillars need some repair, some time may be spent also, you know. But we should not forget about the top, the epitome, the kalash on top of the gopuram. That should always be shining. You know? They do that. Generally, when they do repairs and renovations of these traditional temples, kalash is there. They keep doing repairs, strengthening of the foundation is there. But then the service to the kalash is paramount, which is embodied by the deity. The service to the deity has to continue in the temple, you know, symbolically. So our devotional service should continue. And after completing our devotional service, if we have the time and energy and the ordain, if we have been asked by some senior devotee or spiritual master to do something about, you know, strengthening some of the pillars, yes, we can. You know, and but as far as taking shelter goes, shelter is always devotional service. Responsibility, yes, that's different. You know, and while executing our responsibilities, the moment we sense danger in any of our life's aspirations, spiritual or material, our shelter is devotional service. Okay. Anything more complex than this? It's dharma, so we don't know. Guidance of devotees, as you mentioned, I said ordained. You know, question repeat. Prabhuji is asking that sometimes we have to do some apad dharma activities, and we get stuck in that due to circumstances or due to our own conditioning, our weakness. Then how to make sure that we don't stay in the apad dharma for too long and timely come back to our sadharan dharma. Lucky are those who are surrounded by devotees who can tell us, Prabhu, abhi thoda maya ho raha hai, please move on, you know. So there is nothing like being surrounded by devotees. That's the best. And anything, any other option is there? So no. So association of devotees is the most important. We never know when. So many times we walk past, go past so many devotees. That is okay, you're not yet familiar with the devotee, and I'm not yet familiar with the devotee, but sometimes we have negative feelings also towards devotees. You know, I don't like this person, I don't like this Prabhu, I don't like this Mataji. We never know when we will take, in what situation, in which place we will take our last breath, and who is the devotee who is going to be there who can chant Krishna's name in our ears. Who knows? If you have negative feeling towards somebody, you can always think, what if something happens to me now, there is nobody else, he is there. He is the only one who can scream Krishna into my ears. You know, so we can think like that, we can try to move on. So association of devotees. Time. So Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Anantakoti Vaishnava Vrinda ki, Nitya Gaur Premanande.